Music. It's the love of music that brings us together. The love of music that forms the bond between us. For the next hour, join us for the love of music, presenting those aspects of music which excite, provoke, and inspire. Our host today is David Dubal, WNCN Music Director, pianist, educator, and writer on music. Here is David Dubal for the love of music.
This is David Dubal, and today I am pleased to have as my guest one of the great musicians in New York and one of the great teachers of the piano practicing that profession on this planet. And his name is Josef Raieff, and thank you for coming here, Mr. Raieff.
Well, thank you for inviting me, David. I'm very, very happy to be a guest of WNCN. I've enjoyed listening to your wonderful programs and to all the wonderful music that WNCN provides the public, so I'm very happy to be your guest.
Josef Raieff, it's a long time that I have known you. Although we don't see each other frequently, we always give each other a good smile, I would say. Do you know how I came to you, really, in my life? Well, two of your students were very influential in my life. One, Willem Muller, and another, James Stream. And they both, and I will say this point blank, adored you both as a man and as an artist. And before I myself came to Juilliard, all I heard was Joe Raieff. Well, finally I got there, I played for you, and we became friends and so forth. And both of those students are now very important people. James Stream is on the faculty of the University of Florida, I think, right, or Florida State.
Correct.
And that brings to the point here that, in a way, you have a progeny all over the place, as they say, all over America, a major piano teacher as yourself, and I should add right now that you are the head, no less, the head of the piano department at the celebrated Juilliard School. All over this country, your progeny are placed in various positions in universities, and they're playing the piano, and they're teaching. So your influence goes on and on in subtle ways all over a geographical area. Have you ever thought of it like that?
Well, it's occurred to me that my students are now teaching all over the country. And in fact, some of them also teaching in Europe and playing in Europe. And this gives me great pleasure in the fact that I've had something to do with their success and with their teaching ability and their ability to carry on the traditions which I have inherited from the masters, the great masters that I've been fortunate enough to work with, such as Alexander Cilotti, Joseph Levine, Arthur Schnabel, and Harold Bauer, just before he died. So in this way, I'm very, very happy that I've been able to give this to my students and that they're able to carry this on.
It's a great thing because this historical link in piano teaching has always fascinated me. You have just mentioned some of the great names and figures in the history of the piano. Levine, Solati. Solati was Rachmaninoff's cousin. Harold Bauer, Schnabel, all very different. One an Englishman, another one Germanic, Schnabel's. Beethoven must have been a great influence to you. Tell me of this experience.
Well, Schnabel was always a great inspiration. His lessons were marvelous because he was such an inspiring personality, a great intellect, a great musician. You never played for him alone at a lesson. There were never less than 12 to 20 students, past, present, and future, in the studio, so that a lesson with him was a three-dimensional experience. You played for him, it was a lesson, you felt you were giving a concert because there were 20 students there, and you were playing for your peers. So the challenge and the test was tremendous.
Wow.
He actually didn't teach, he coached. If you weren't ready for him, it was a waste of time. Joseph Levine was a tremendous, tremendous pianist of the golden age of piano playing in Russia. And he was a very gentle personality, and you gained a great deal from him in the musical and pianistic sense. And just watching him and listening to him demonstrate at the piano was in itself an enormous experience. Alexander Siloti was a legendary figure when he came to America as the teacher of Rachmaninoff, a pupil of Liszt, Tchaikovsky, and Anton Rubinstein, the conductor of the Petrograd Philharmonic and the Moscow Opera, and a friend and a sponsor of Scriabin and his music. And this was a great experience from the point of view of firsthand knowledge of the great Russian tradition. Mm-hmm. And Harold Bauer was another wonderful, wonderful experience. I was older by that time. I had already come back from Europe. I had already been in the army. And I was trying to find myself again and reestablish myself again, and Harold Bauer helped me to do that. He was a wonderful intellect. He was a most worldly and sophisticated personality and a tremendous musician. And I was very, very fortunate in being able to meet and in being able to study with all these men. Circumstances at that time made it possible for me, so I was very, very lucky.
That part of your life indeed has been rich. Joseph Raieff, you knew, obviously, Mrs. Levine, the famous Rosina Levine, who was the wife of your teacher, Joseph, and you were fellow faculty members, and she became one of the great legends in the history of piano teaching. We're going to talk a little about her, but first I want the audience to hear a very rare, it's going to only be a fragment, about 3 minutes and 30 seconds of an Allegro Brillante by Mendelssohn, performed by Rosina Levine and yourself. Tell me how this came about. I thought she only played with Joseph.
Well, she did only play with Joseph, and her concerts with him were legendary and wonderful as a two-piano team. After he died, she didn't play for some years, and after 8 years, some of the wounds were healed, and I had my appointment at the Juilliard School. We were colleagues by that time and the very, very best of friends. And 8 years after his death, she decided to play again. WQXR station had Saturday night concerts in those days, broadcasts, mm-hmm. and they invited us to perform four hands, some of the wonderful literature of four hands, Schubert Fantasy, Poulenc Sonata, the Mendelssohn Allegro Brillante, Mozart Sonata. And we did two Saturday night broadcasts of these pieces. And I was the first one after her husband died 8 years later for her to play ensemble with. And I was very, very grateful and very, very happy to be able to collaborate with her. And this piece that you're going to hear was one of the pieces that we played that night.
Well, we're going to go now back 30 years or more, and we're going to hear the Allegro Brillante of Mendelssohn's, this fragment with Rosina Levine and Joseph Raieff. And here it is. Thank you. That was from the Allegro Brillante of Mendelssohn, and what a stunning and bristling kind of scherzando feeling that Mendelssohn needs in that performance. Really a tremendous piece of nostalgia, Josef Raieff, my guest, and the legendary Rosina Levine in that performance. We'll be right back with my guest, Josef Raieff, after this message. This is David Dubal, and my guest is Josef Raieff, head of the piano department at the celebrated Juilliard School in New York. Hearing that piece with Rosina Levine must have just brought memories flooding back.
It does bring memories back. It also brings memories back of the rehearsals I had with her for these broadcasts. She was a perfectionist, if ever there was one.
But you are too.
Well, I am too, but she was really almost obsessive in her quest for perfection. And in this way, she was always a complete pro. And we had a lot of rehearsals. We rehearsed during lunch periods. We rehearsed in the evenings until we felt we got it right. So it was very nostalgic. It brought us closer together in playing together as ensemble does with musicians. And it was a very joyous time. I remember it very gratefully.
Now you have all of these influences in your life with Zolotti and Levine, Harold Bauer, Schnabel. You were born in, really the magic place, Kharkov,
in Ukraine,
and Kiev, Odessa. All the air there, Josef, must create pianists and violinists. Is that right?
Yes, it seems. It seems so. I don't know whether it's still doing it. But Kharkov at that time was the capital of the Ukraine. I know that the Levines came from Kiev, I think.
Horowitz
comes from Odessa or from Kiev. And many of the great Russian pianists at that time came from that part of the world. So maybe the climate or the geography does have something to do with it.
That will be a topic long discussed. You came to America. You went to Chicago. Was that a musical city when you came to America?
Well, that's a very, very interesting story. Chicago in those days was not considered a cultural center. Mm-hmm. And the way we got to Chicago was that my uncle first left Russia to come and learn to be a piano tuner in the only school of piano tuning in America at that time, which was, I think, in Peru, Indiana. I think he heard about this, and he wanted music more than anything in his life. So he left Russia, came to Peru, Indiana, studied piano tuning for a year, and then went to Chicago, which was nearby, and was practically the only piano tuner in Chicago for many, many years. After he came, this started an exodus of all the Raieffs. His family came, and then my father, who was his brother, followed with his family, and that's how I landed in Chicago and got my early musical education there.
Fantastic. You know, we're going to hear a performance of you now in concerto. We heard you in two piano with Rosina Levine, and we're going to hear a work that was very popular at that time in America when you were playing it, or would be, and it's a stunning performance, and it's the Khachaturian Concerto, the last movement. What do you have to say about this in this period? You were in the Army, you said.
Well, I was in the Army. I can't remember whether this performance with the Dayton Philharmonic was while I was in the Army or whether it was right after I was discharged and came back to New York and was invited to play. I played several times with the Dayton Orchestra. And I spent the last year of my Army service in Dayton, Ohio, which I was very, very fond of. They had a very good orchestra, of which Paul Katz was for many years the founder and the conductor. And this goes back, I think, to 1948 or 1949, sometime around there, which had to be after the war then.
Yeah, the Khachaturian
Concerto.
Yeah,
it had to be after the war.
Josef, this is going to be the last movement, and I know that you haven't heard it in a long time. I think you're going to be absolutely impressed with yourself. Let's hear the Dayton Philharmonic, Paul Katz conducting, and the last movement of Khachaturian's Piano Concerto.
Thank you.
Bravo indeed. Josef Raieff in the last movement of the Kutchaturian Piano Concerto, those big D flats, Joseph. Paul Katz conducted the Dayton Philharmonic. How come that piece isn't played anymore much?
I really don't know. I don't understand it. It's a good whammy concerto. I think it has something for everybody. It's musically very, very honest. And it's just possible that this would have been a very, very popular concerto, one of the 20th century popular concertos, if the Prokofiev Third Piano Concerto hadn't been written.
Yeah. Someone, I think, Rudolf Ganz from your home city of Chicago once said right. that the Prokofiev Third is the Grieg minor of the 20th century.
Yeah, that's interesting. I never heard that. But, well, the Prokofiev Third certainly deserves deserves its place in history and in the repertoire. I think the Prokofiev Third and the Rachmaninoff Third are the two greatest 20th century pieces written.
But both of them written before 1920, the Rock III in 1909 and the Prokofiev in 17. So the 20th century has not been good to us in repertory piano concertos.
Oh, that's true. And that's another reason why I think the Kutchaturian should be resurrected and revived and played more. Unfortunately, pieces like Fashions have their vogue come and go.
That's absolutely true. Mr. Raieff, if you wait for a second, I will be right back because we have to have some messages.
Fine.
My guest today, the eminent teacher and pianist, Josef Raieff, and he has been on the faculty of the Juilliard School for 37 years. So when I said you have your progeny all over America, your children, you gave them what your teachers, Levine, Bauer, Salati, and Schnabel, gave you, obviously. Is there, I'm going to ask you in a minute what it has meant to you to be on that celebrated faculty, but are there differences in piano playing? Is there really a Russian way and a Germanic one?
Well, that's a very good question, a very interesting question. There are people, there are pianists who would discount the whole idea of a Russian school of piano playing, of a German school of piano playing, of a French school of piano playing. And one could enter into a whole dialectical conversation and discussion on this thing, and it could be very debatable and very arguable. However, the Russian school of piano playing, I think, was exemplified by the great Russian and Polish pianists such as Hoffmann and Rachmaninoff and Rubinstein. In our day, Richter, Ashkenazi, Gilels. So I think without actually defining, without an actual definition, I think we know what synthesizes or what synchronizes with Russian piano playing. The German school has been known to be more intellectual, a little heavier fare, possibly. Beethoven, Bach, Brahms, and so forth. So I think we know pretty much what that school means. The French school, which is exemplified by Debussy and Ravel, and the light touch and the elegance and the refinement, which one could describe French painting or French dress or French food, etc., etc. So I think without any deep discussion or definitions, I think we know pretty much what the differences are.
Very interesting. We're going to have a performance of one of the great works in the literature, and one of Schnabel's and one of Myra Hess's great performances. You studied it possibly with Schnabel, the 109.
Yes, I worked 109 with, to begin with Alexander Szilotti, mm-hmm. who rarely taught the late sonatas. I don't know how I ever got that out of him. But I started my work with that, with Szilotti, and then later on with Schnabel. And I was lucky enough to study it when I was very young and grow with it and mature with it until I got to Schnabel. And this, I think, one of the loveliest of the 32 sonatas, one of my favorites.
Oh, I love it, too. I know you taught it to Willem Muller.
Yes, that's right. I taught it to many students, and I'm still teaching it for graduation and for students entering the doctoral degrees, and it's a favorite. Along with 110, Opus 110, it's a great favorite.
Now, I'd like to ask you something. Why didn't Zolotti want to teach late Beethoven? Was he of that school that said you had to be over 50 to play these wonderful poems of humanity?
Yes, I think it's wonderful that you asked me that question, because when I once asked him for the Chromatic Fantasy and Fugue, I think I was 18 at the time, he looked at me and then shook his finger and he says wistfully, very wistfully and regretfully, he said, when you are 35, maybe you can play the Chromatic Fantasy and Fugue.
Wonderful.
So when you say, was he the kind that said you had to be 50 years old to play the late sonatas? Yes, he was. He was that way.
Uh-huh.
He was that way. He believed in people maturing up to the level of the composition. There are two schools of thought about that.
It's a very interesting point. We're going to hear your performance now, Josef Raieff, playing Beethoven's truly immortal Opus 109, the Sonata number 30 in E major. the magnificence of Beethoven's 30th piano sonata in the hands of my guest, Josef Raieff. And after this message, we will return with a final few sentences from Josef Raieff. Josef, while we were listening to that, you were reminiscing about the time you played it for the great Edwin Fischer. Can you say a word about that?
Yes, when I was playing in Europe, I came to Switzerland. I visited Edwin Fischer, whom I've always admired tremendously. He had been ill. He had been in the hospital for a time. And I was going to spend a short evening with him. It turned out to be a very long evening of 4 hours. And he asked me to play for him. We went into his studio. He had two magnificent Bechstein pianos. And I played this sonata for him. Afterwards, he seemed very, very moved. And the whole experience was very touching and moving to me, too, because when he wanted to demonstrate certain things for me in certain places in the sonata, he could scarcely move his fingers. He is almost he was almost paralyzed at that time. And this experience was very, very sad. It's the last time I'd seen Mr. Fischer. He was a great pianist and a great musician. And I was very, very happy that I had a chance to be with him at that time and also to play the sonata.
Josef Raieff, the head of the Juilliard Piano Department, for 37 years you've been there. What has it meant to you?
Well, Juilliard is a magical name. I was a student there years before that of Alexander Zulotti and Joseph Levine. And then when I came back after the war to teach there, it's always been a very enriching and a rewarding experience because the school always offered the very best curriculum and had a wonderful faculty and attracted all of the greatest students in the entire world, which it still does. And teaching on that level has been a great experience for me because I've learned so much from it myself. And it has enriched my life because of my contact with these young people. And even though we all grow older, the student body never does.
That
keeps us young. Uh-huh. I appreciate that very much.
That's absolutely wonderful. Josef Raieff has been my guest today, and you have given that school many, many years of history that you have added to it. And it's been a pleasure to hear the art of Josef Raieff on the piano as well. Thanks a million for coming.
Thank you, David. I enjoyed it very much.
This is David Dubal, and thank you for listening.
For the Love of Music, with today's host, David Dubal, WNCN Music Director. We hope you'll be with us when once again we meet to listen and exchange ideas. All for the love of music. For the Love of Music is produced by WNCN New York, GAF Broadcasting Company. Thank you.